Good morning, saints. Good morning, sinners. We're all here. We can't start till we're all here. It is a good and glorious thing to be together in worship today here at Central United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Michelle, and with me today is Pastor Paul, and you'll hear from him in a minute. But it is good, no matter if you're here in the sanctuary or joining us on YouTube or by cable TV later this week, to be in worship together in many spaces, in many ways. We are at a COVID medium level in Broome County now. We are continuing to mask to your comfort level. So if you feel like wearing a mask, please do. If you don't, please don't. That's fine. If you will find, though, the brown pad in the pew near you and write your name and contact information, we need that for, well, to keep in touch, but also that is our contact tracing for New York State. So if you happen to test positive for COVID this week, I hope that's not true for anyone, please call the office as soon as you know, and we will notify the folks who are sitting around you so they know, okay? So please fill that out, tear it out, and leave it on top of the pad in the pew. If you are joining from another place than here, I invite you to the front page of the website where you can click on the button for the order of worship if you'd like to follow along. That also has all our bulletin announcements and upcoming things through the week, as well as information about Central. So if you'd like that, go to the front page of centralumcendicott.org and you can click on that. Let's see if I have done everything I'm supposed to do. Ah, I have. So we've come together to worship. May the Holy Spirit fill this time and whatever space we're in. May the Holy Spirit fill our hearts that all we do here may be to the glory of God. Welcome to worship.
Good morning. That was a little lame. Good morning. Better. My name is Pastor Paul Reed, the associate pastor here, and I want to start. This is not on my script, but I want to start with a question. Raise your hand if you did the dishes. Excellent, good. Those of you that have no clue what I'm talking about, watch last week's message. We have a lot of people helping us out in worship this morning. Sean Stafford and the Chancel Choir will be leading us in music. Tom Hall is going to be reading scripture. Roger Richards will be playing the organ for the second hymn and the postlude, I think, right? Yeah-ish, something like that. So we've got lots of kind of music today. The tech team in the back, thank you for maintaining volumes and everything, and trying to maintain volumes. We have people here that are working on our chat, so if you're watching us via live YouTube, you have the ability to chat and respond, to put in prayer concerns, and so the people here doing that are also going to moderate things so we don't get too out of control. But we're gathered here to worship this morning. We may be gathered here presently, or we may be gathered in living rooms or bedrooms or back porches or wherever we are, but we join everyone's hearts together with God's presence and the Holy Spirit with us. So if you would please pray with me. The words are on the screen. They're in the bulletin. If you're on watching us remotely, you can grab that off the webpage. So would you please pray with me? Jesus, you call me from what I know to something new, from a life on this sea with this family, from the nets of generations before me. You call me to be a new beginning, and doing you, call me, follow, sorry, to move and become. Help me turn towards you. Help me follow. Help me believe and trust you fully. Immediately, help me live into my chosenness to lay down what I know and pick up the new. Empower me to go out with you, across, beyond, and into the deep, bringing in your wild, shining kingdom. Full nets. Our first hymn this morning is number 344 in the Red United Methodist Hymnal. Lord, you have come to the lakeshore. If you would and are able, please rise and join as you can. Mm-hmm.
While you are standing or not, while you are present or in another place, I invite you to exchange the signs of Christ's peace with each other. We've been doing that in a COVID-safe way, but there's lots of ways to do this. With American Sign Language, it is right palm on top of left. Turn your hands around and bring your arms back to your sides. And then hands together, knuckles together with thumbs on top, and extend that from your body. So that is peace I give to you. I invite you to exchange that or other signs of peace if you're in the room. If you are at home, I invite you to exchange signs of peace with those around you. If it's just your dog or cat, that's fine too. If nobody's there, go to the front door, open it wide, and throw that peace out into the neighborhood.
This morning's scripture reading comes from the book of Matthew, verses 12 through 25, chapter 4. And it comes from the interpretation of the Message. When Jesus got word that John had been arrested, he returned to Galilee. He moved from his hometown, Nazareth, to the lakeside village of Capernaum, nestled at the base of the Zebulun and Naphtali hills. This move completed Isaiah's revelation. Land of Zebulun and Naphtali, road to the sea, over Jordan, Galilee, crossroads for the nations. People sitting out their lives in the dark saw a huge light. Sitting in that dark, dark country of death, they watched the sun come up. This Isaiah prophesied revelation came to life in Galilee the moment Jesus started preaching. He picked up where John left off. Change your life. God's kingdom is here. Walking along the beach of Lake Galilee, Jesus saw two brothers, Simon, later called Peter, and Andrew. They were fishing, throwing their nets into the lake. It was their regular work. Jesus said to them, "Come with me. I will make you a new kind of fisherman out of you. I will show you how to catch men and women instead of perch and bass." They didn't ask questions, but simply dropped their nets and followed. A short distance down the beach, they came upon another pair of brothers, James and John, Zebedee's sons. These two were sitting in the boat with their father, Zebedee, mending their fish nets. Jesus made the same offer to them, and they were just as quick to follow, abandoning boat and father. From there he went all over Galilee. He used synagogues for meeting places and taught people the truth of God. God's kingdom was his theme, that beginning right now, they were under God's government, a good government. He also healed people of their diseases and of the bad effects of their bad lives.
Okay, and to continue. Word got around the entire Roman province of Syria. People brought anybody with a sickness, whether mental, emotional, physical. Jesus healed them one and all. More and more people came, the momentum gathering. Besides those from Galilee, crowds came from the 10 towns across the lake, others up from Jerusalem and Judea, still others from across the Jordan. I guess that went on to page 2. Sorry, Tom. So, did you ever think about this? What did it mean to follow Jesus in his world? Way back then, on the shores of the Sea of Galilee. In Jesus' world, the people who flocked to him wanted to be taught. They wanted to know God. They wanted a life change. They wanted a world change. They had heard wonderful things about him and gathered in huge groups and small bands to hear what he had to say because they were promised something amazing. Where they were wasn't great. The Roman Empire offered peace only through violence. Money was in the hands of the 1%. Power was in the hands of those who collaborated with Roman rule. God was the only thing left for the least and the left out and the left behind. And they knew it. Jesus offered a glimpse of something larger, something more powerful, more life-fulfilling than any of them had ever known. And so they came and they followed because the invitation and the life he offered to them was not based on what they had or who they knew or on following tradition for tradition's sake or because they had earned it or because someone else said they were worthy of it. This story of the calling of the disciples sounds extraordinary to our ears today, but maybe it's not when you consider all of that. One tradition has it that Andrew, this first disciple called, had been following John the Baptizer as John was teaching about the one to come. Was it easy to follow Jesus for Andrew when he called because John had already been pointing him out? Maybe. What about Simon, Andrew's brother, and James and John? Why did they follow so easily, dropping their nets, leaving family behind? Is Jesus even that much of a thing yet? It's only chapter 4. He's just moved to Capernaum from Nazareth, as this gospel tells the story. It must have been great gnawing need and helpless hunger. The search for hope must have been intense, just to drop everything and follow. Drop everything and follow Jesus just because he asked them to. What had they heard about him? And what had they heard from him that made it sound reasonable and sensible and logical to follow at the drop of a hat? It sounds like an extraordinary experience. And what does it mean to be a Christian and to follow Jesus in our world? The conditions are eerily similar, though in a completely different context. People in our culture are looking for the same things, for healing and help and hope in a violent and unstable world. The answers should be the same for us now as it was for them then. Jesus' message hasn't changed. But I suppose it is fair to say that many Christians have changed Jesus' message for him. In his name. What began as Jesus teaching about a way of life that was of the Spirit, centered wholeheartedly in God, a way of life anchored in love that allowed for no insider-outsider language, no power plays, no inequality or injustice perpetrated by those who followed him, has become in far too many places and in far too many people a religion of power dynamics and stuck tradition and purchased grace and self-righteous self-importance. There's a book called A Conspiracy of Love written by Kurt Struckmeyer, and he says this: at the heart of Christianity is a powerful ethic. It is what the first followers of Jesus called the way, a way of living based on love and compassion and reconciliation and forgiveness, inclusion and acceptance, peace and nonviolence, generosity and justice. This ethic is what makes Christianity good. Without it, Christians can become rigid and intolerant, self-righteous and condemning, hate-filled and violent, selfish and unjust. Amen. I heard someone say once that they really would want—they would love to see an episode of Undercover Boss. Have you seen the show? Undercover Boss, where Jesus comes back and visits Joel Osteen's church. I'd pay money to see that. I never saw the day coming when I would have to say, I'm not that kind of Christian as much as I do. Truth be told, I never saw it coming that I would have to say it at all. Now, some of that is the blissful naivete I carried into ministry. But it's not all me. What have Christians done to Christianity and to such an extent that we have to convince people that Jesus isn't about judgment or condemnation or hate or prejudice or persecution? The first step to following Jesus these days, unlike at the shores of the Sea of Galilee, the first step to following Jesus, if you've never been introduced to him, is not just dropping your nets and going. It's trying to understand that Jesus is a good guy and that God really is in the love business. But you see the counterargument everywhere. The internet, social media, current events, politics, government, even on church signs. Pray or be prey. Turn or burn. And I'm not even going to get into the legions of church signs that slur people based on race, economics, politics, or gender identity or orientation. You can Google that if you want to. It's a nasty little rabbit hole to go down. But if you want to, start with Westboro Baptist Church. No, they're not Baptist. I'm not sure they're a church. Kind of my point. Legally, they're a church, right? This is what the world around us sees. These are the folks hogging the microphones and in front of the cameras. Who wants to follow that Jesus? The Jesus who makes impossible rules. The Jesus who promises financial and tangible rewards for good behavior. The Jesus who expects or wants his followers to take judging and smiting into their own hands. Too many people call themselves Christians, yet take it upon themselves to enforce their own prejudices, to act as judge, jury, and executioner, sometimes using God's name. 5 days ago, the New York Times reported that there have already been 39 mass shootings in 2023. Mass shootings being a victim count of at least 3 or 4, not counting the shooter. We haven't had 39 days in 2023 yet. And that was 5 days ago. I wonder if the current number's higher. And this week, the death of Tyree Nichols. Yet another black man killed on camera for the world to see and to grieve. Now, since Pew reports that 80% of Americans still consider themselves to be Christian. Odds are that most of these murders committed this month were committed by people who call themselves Christian and who say they love and follow Jesus. I don't want to follow that Jesus. The Reverend Bed Creamer posted recently, "Jesus laying down his life out of love for the world rather than conquering it with angel armies to force it to obey his will is the eternal critique to any Christian theology that believes it must conquer the culture for Jesus rather than let his love conquer our own hearts." He said a few days later, "Part of the greatest commandment Christ gave to his disciples is to love your neighbor. Not control your neighbor, not mock your neighbor, not shame your neighbor, not dehumanize your neighbor, not demonize your neighbor, not defeat your neighbor, love your neighbor." That's the Jesus of the first disciples at Capernaum. That's the Jesus of the early church. That's an ethic of relationship, not rules. It's an ethic of love, not legalism. The Apostle Paul, our historian of the early church, pretty much the inventor of the early church, author of much of our New Testament, would say this of his own conversion and faith. It's from a letter to his church at Galatia, probably around the year 48, so pretty early on. And he's talking about his conversion. He says, "What actually took place is this. I tried keeping rules and working my head off to please God, and it didn't work. So I quit being a lawman so that I could be God's man. Christ's life showed me how and enabled me to do it. I identified myself completely with him. Indeed, I have been crucified with Christ. My ego is no longer central. It is no longer important that I appear righteous before you or have your good opinion. And I'm no longer driven to impress God. Christ lives in me. The life you see me living is not mine, but it is lived by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I'm not going to go back on that. Is it not clear to you that to go back to that old rule-keeping, peer-pleasing religion would be an abandonment of everything personal and free in my relationship to God? I refuse to do that. To repudiate God's grace. If a living relationship with God could come by rule keeping, then Christ died unnecessarily." Powerful ethic of love. How many of us are able to name what we dropped to follow Jesus? I think most Christians, including myself, more or less, try to take everything with us when we follow Jesus. How many of us can describe how following Jesus has transformed our lives? Can we honestly say that all the time we live with Jesus at our center, not with our own ideas of righteousness or justice or politics or worthiness at our center? The theologian Karl Barth wrote in The Humanity of God, "This much is certain, that we have no theological right to set any sort of limits to the loving kindness of God, which has appeared in Jesus Christ. Our theological duty is to see and to understand it as being still greater than we had seen before." That's why they dropped their nets and followed. Because in Jesus they saw something greater than they'd ever seen before. They saw a loving kindness without limit, and they were ready to go anywhere with him. They were ready to proclaim it everywhere. Truly following Jesus means to drop whatever we're holding dear, whatever we're clenching tightly, in favor of being part of something bigger than ourselves, bigger than we've ever seen before. God's loving kindness is a gift, but it's not meant to be kept to ourselves. It's meant to be multiplied through us. It's meant to be shared with the world. It's meant to be cast out from all the corners of the earth. That's discipleship. May it be so in each of our lives, for all of our lives. And may the world know Jesus by it. Amen.
One faith.
That was excellent. Really good, yeah. Could we be in an attitude of prayer, please? Holy and gracious God, we thank you for bringing us together here this morning. God, we address our joys and concerns at this moment. Please keep in mind members of our central family, Jane Allen, Kevin and Steve Briggs, Terry Crump, Vicky Fiacco, Connie Hasto, Jill Jordan, Francis Misteller, Paul and Deb Phillips, Jim and Leslie Snyder, Susan and Brian Whipp. We ask also that you shed your grace and mercy and peace on Margaret Frederick, Richard Frederick, Cindy Tedeschi, Carla Wood, Pam Russell, Noreen Breyer, Randy Foote, Tom Burgode, Heather Warden, Sherlyn O'Brien, and Martina DeRose.
We bring all these to prayer. There are some prayers coming through the chat as well. Some interesting things here too. Thank you, God, for carrying a family through an emergency with their small son and to ask for his continued health. One of our folks in Florida, I love this, Lisa, spent a wonderful weekend with her cousin from Ohio before sending her off to an alligator hunt. She got one, and yes, they're delicious. Someone saw God in the beautiful, much-needed sunshine. We enjoyed it yesterday. Even the birds were singing and soaring. We carry in prayer this week the families of the victims of 39 shootings. We carry in our prayers this week Tyree's family and the families of 5 police officers. We carry in our prayers those who commit acts of violence, either in Jesus' name or because they don't know who he is or his way of peace. We carry those things heavy in our hearts. We carry the people of California and natural disasters brought by too much water. We continue to carry them. We continue to carry the people of Ukraine and Russia. All the places across the world at war, it's not just there. But we also bring our celebrations. We also have seen God at work this week in our world. We've heard a couple of those already. I'm wondering where God's been at work in your life, in your world, this week. How about the voice of children in the sanctuary? Little Natalie. Yeah, Dee. The blessing of being here and having the freedom to worship as we wish. Amen. Yeah. Sheila says the blessing of good friends is where she sees God at work. Maggie. Two little boys at a swim meet who are joyful and radiating it. That's wonderful. Sherlyn. Caring doctors and nurses. Sherlyn's had a week. And so caring doctors and nurses. And the miracle of medicine. Where else have you seen God at work this week? I see it in folks who offer their gifts and their talents to God every single week. I see it in the warmth of your reception for our new associate pastor. The warmth you have for each other. Shall we enter into prayer together? Take a breath all the way down to your toes if you have to clear the cobwebs, to open a space for the Spirit to come in. Holy and living God, the world is hurting in so many ways. There are so many broken places. There are so many people who feel their lives are broken, their spirits are broken. There is violence and pain. There is loss and fear all around us. And yet we come, seeking hope, seeking light, seeking life, because we know that you are the source. You are life, you are breath, you are being. You are the hope of our hearts. You are the journey of our spirits. You are our home. We know that you should be at the center of everything we are and everything we do, everything we think, everything we speak. But too often, Holy One, we admit we push you off to the side and we put other things at the center. We prioritize other things. We prioritize our own needs, our own wishes, our own prejudices, our own opinions. And we forget to look to you. We forget to live out of the love that you have poured into us. And so where we have gone astray, we ask that you forgive us. Where we have forgotten, we ask that you remind us. Where we have been afraid, we ask that you grant us courage to be your love, to speak your love into this world, to stand up and speak up to injustice and pain and unrighteousness. There is so much in this world that is good to celebrate, but the cameras and the microphones gravitate to the bad and the sad. Help us listen for your voice. Help us to see the helpers. Help us to see all those who follow you in love and truth. Help us to be those. We ask because there are many in our circles who need your love and may only see it through us. We've named some already, but there are so many more we keep in our hearts, family and friends, neighbors, workmates, people we see every day at the grocery store, people who cross our paths occasionally or often, people who struggle, who need help and hope. And so, Holy One, in this sacred moment, wherever we are, we lift their names to you as we speak them aloud. You know their names, you know their stories, you know their needs before we even think to speak them. Yet we ask it anyway in trust and assurance. Lord, in your love, hear our prayers, for we ask each one in the name of Jesus the Christ, the one who is your love in the world, the one who calls us to be that love as well, the one who teaches us always to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us
not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We come now to our time of offering. Jesus taught us how to fish and said, go out and do it. And we do that with our time and our talents, but it also takes financial resources. And so in this time, if you would consider how you can best acknowledge the ministries here and the resources that God has given us during this time of offering. There's a box in the back if you're here present, and there are two mechanisms, direct deposit and donate now button on the webpage, if you would consider that. So as forgiven and reconciled people, let us give unto God what is truly God's, our gifts, our tithes, our offerings, and ourselves. Would you pray with me, please? Holy God, who taught us to fish, to cast out our nets, help us cast them out into this neighborhood and into this community, using the funds, the resources, the time, and the talents that we all have, so that we can go into this world and be fishers of people. Amen. For announcements today, I just said at the 8:30 service, look in your bulletin. So look in your bulletin. But we also have, the website has things to look at. The book study tomorrow night, remember, is on at 7:30. Wednesday is the United Women in Faith meeting at 1 via Zoom. Thursday is Shepherd's Supper. So we've got resources there, time there.
If you want to volunteer for that or any other ministry here, see us after the service. We can help you with that. Or contact the office this week. There's more. You have the bulletin.
Keep going. Well, you have the bulletin. It's yours now. She forgot the bulletin, so I gave her mine.
Yes.
I'm just putting that out there.
We're still working out our choreography.
Our choreography is still off.
You're still on probation.
Yeah. 30 days, doors open, don't let it hit me on the way out, right?
We have rebooted our adult faith formation on Sunday mornings between services in the lounge, that next room over, and Paul is our leader for that and knocking it out of the park two weeks in a row.
We are doing, can I interrupt? Mm-hmm. We're doing the parables, so if you'd like to join us, we're talking next week about, the title in the Bible is probably called The Prodigal Son, but we're going to stretch that a lot. So if you'd like to learn more about that, please join us.
Right. If you'd like to participate in bell choir or chancel choir, they would love to talk to you. Carolyn and Denise would love to talk to you about that. So just so you know about that, let's see. Just a reminder, since we had two snow days this week, when UE schools close, our office will be closed. Our new secretary lives up on a hill in Windsor. And so we are working very hard to get it where she can do all of her work from home. There's a little bit of transition to do there. So if you called the office or emailed the office and didn't get a response, we thank you for your patience. And feel free to call again this week. But just know that the office won't be open if the schools aren't open. But we're trying to get that work accomplished remotely. Any other announcements that I have forgotten? If you would like to be one of the scripture readers for the service, Tyler can help you sign up for that. He's back in the tech booth. If you would like to be an usher or a liturgist, Diana up here in the red would love to talk to you about that. So we've got room for everyone. And if you feel God nudging you to do something, I invite you to talk to any of these folks. As we close our worship this morning, we sing. And it is 2137 in the little black paperback hymnal in front of you, on the screen as well. Would I have answered when you called? Stand as you feel comfortable and willing. come on. As you go into this day and into this week and into this world, choose which Jesus you're going to follow. And may you go in his peace. Amen.